So hello, I'm Bastien, product director. So just a word on what product management is, because it might not be a function that everyone knows. So the product management team is the team in charge of making sure we build the right products by bridging the gaps between the commercial teams on one side, who understand the business requirements, and the engineering team on the other side, who know what we can build or cannot build. So before I jump to the real content of my presentation, an introduction of what Criteo provides as a technology. So we provide a performance marketing technology to our clients, which are mainly e-commerce websites and mostly retailers. And most of the users who visit e-commerce websites browse and see some products, but they leave the site without buying anything. And what we do at Criteo is we try to find those users again on publisher websites and show them personalized ads, hoping they will click on the banner, which redirect them to the e-commerce website and conclude their transaction on the e-commerce website. And what's important to understand is we pay for every impression we make, so every display we make, but we only get paid when the user click on the banner. And actually, what our clients want us to do is to generate transaction, post-click transactions, and what we are really paid on is on those post-click transactions. And because we pay for every impression, but we only get paid for post-click transactions on e-commerce websites, we need to be able to very accurately predict the probability of a click and the probability of a transaction after a click. And we need that to make different types of decision. The first one is how much do we bid for a given ad opportunity, which decides whether the user will be exposed or not. The second one is once we buy a display, what are the products we want to recommend to this user, knowing what we know about him. And finally, what's the best look and feel for the banner. And all the machine learning we use to make those decisions is what we call the Criteo engine. And today, I'm not going to tell you about the secret sauce, but more on lessons that we've learned at Criteo, having worked on a machine learning project for the last 8 years. So before I do that, what I'm going to say might very well be Criteo specific, so I hope some of it will be interesting to you, but some of it might be very specific to what we do. And we think machine learning is a particular to Criteo because for two reasons. The first one is our machine learning algorithm, they make the decision. So they decide how much we should bid, they decide the product we should recommend, and it has a direct impact on our campaigns. While in most cases, you have teams of data analysts who work on machine learning, who have results that they provide to other people who make the decision. So there is not a direct link between the data, the machine learning, and the decision making. And the second reason is these decisions are really the core of our technology, and what we sell to our clients. If tomorrow we come up with a new product recommendation engine that generates twice as many transactions, our revenue would almost immediately be multiplied by factor two. So the machine learning has a direct impact on our revenue. So it's really the core of our technology. So the first lesson is when you work on data and machine learning, you need to have a very clear objective that you can measure with a very well-defined success KPI. And to give you an example, a few years ago, we had an engine that was trying to maximize clicks on our banner, but not necessarily transaction after the click. And as our clients were interested in post-click transactions, we decided to improve our engine so that it would maximize those post-click transactions. And when we tested this first version of this new version of the engine, what we saw was lower revenue for Criteo, less transactions for our clients, but a much better ROI. So we thought we felt this new version of the engine was better, but we didn't have a very clear and single KPI to prove it, and it generated a long discussion internally on whether or not we should deploy this new version of our engine. And so we had to work a few quarters, it was a significant amount of time, to define this success KPI. And it required us understanding how our revenue, the transactions we generate, the ROI depends on each other. Run experiment on this. but also develop tools so that every time we test a new version of the engine, we know how it impacts this success KPI. Also, we had to discuss this internally because we had to make sure the commercial team understood this this metric and was okay with us making our decisions on this metric. So the second lesson is even in a world where machine learning is the king, skills like intuition, experience, business understanding are very important. And sometimes you have this idea that if you find the right machine learning algorithm, you can just throw the data and the algorithm will figure it out. And we don't think that works. And the reason why it doesn't work is there are many ways you can solve machine learning problems. There are many different sources of data you can use. And so the space you have to explore is very big. Also, exploring this space is quite expensive. So building a new machine learning model is expensive. Sourcing the data is always more expensive than you think. So it's quite painful to explore this space. And so the idea that you can have an exhaustive approach where you just test everything and select the best implementation doesn't work. And usually you have to select the ideas you want to invest in based on your intuition and your experience. So those skills are very important to pick and choose the ideas, but also in the implementation of those ideas. The third one is even if you identify a great idea, you generally have to iterate a lot on the idea before you can make it work. And if you want to do that efficiently, you have to invest a lot in the tooling to do that. And this is the framework we have at Criteo to go from an idea in someone's mind to a live feature on our platform. And so, as I explained, first step is people's intuition. So I think this might be interesting. Then what we do is we run very basic analysis to make sure there is potential in the idea. So we look at the scope of the idea. Does it concern 5% of our traffic? 10%, 50%, and whether the signal seems high enough. And then we do what we call offline testing, meaning we implement the idea in our machine learning models, but we run those models on historical data, so with no impact on our live campaigns. And then we look at how much we can improve the accuracy of our prediction. And as you can see, we do that a lot. Last year, we ran 50,000 offline tests. And once we've done that, so we've eliminated a few IDs, for the ones who are still there, what we do is online testing, which is obviously more expensive than offline testing because you have to do some engineering work to be able to live test your idea. And we run what we call A-B tests. I'm sure you all know A-B tests. So A-B tests means you randomize the users, and on 50% of your traffic, you use your reference models, and on 50%, the new models you want to test, and you look at how much you improve your success KPI. And last year, we ran 500 A-B tests. To be able to run this number of offline and online tests, we invested in the tools, so we have tools with nice UIs that allow us to easily launch a test, to easily analyze the test, and that's really key in what we do. The fourth idea is we've tried as hard as we could to keep things simple. And we had many forces, whether internally or externally, that were pushing us towards building complex machine learning models. The first reason is sometimes, yes, when you complexify your models, you can improve the performance. Sometimes clients would ask you to adapt your models to their specific needs. And sometimes we just do it by ourselves because making complicated things makes you look smarter, so which obviously is not a very good reason. But there is always a hidden cost to this complexity, because when you have complex models, then it's much harder and slower to improve them afterwards. It takes more time to onboard new people and to have them contribute on your projects. And sometimes if you push this to the extreme, you can even end up in a situation where you don't understand anymore what you're doing and you're just stuck. So we should not underestimate this cost, this hidden cost of complexity. And as a matter of fact, every year we have some improvements that generate value, but that we decide not to deploy because we think the value is not worth the added complexity that they bring, which is obviously a hard decision to make. The last idea I wanted to share, which is maybe obvious, but I think it's an important one, is when you work on data, the more data you have, the more accurate you can be. And we've made a decision a long time ago at Crypto to only have one machine learning models for all our clients. And because we did that, it enabled us to use all the data we have to train our engine on a dimension that are common to all our clients, and mainly the publisher dimension. So understanding which publisher perform better, which publisher perform worse. And because we use all our data to understand that, we can predict the performance, so probability of a click, probability of a transaction, at a very granular level than to the URL of the publisher, which is something you couldn't do if you train your engine using only one client's data set. And because we did that, there is some virtuous circle that we call network effects, where you deliver a better performance than your competitors. So you have more clients, and because you have more clients, you have more data to train your engine, and you increase your performance. And this graph shows you what happens for Criteo. So the x-axis is the years, y-axis is the number of variables we use in our engine, and the size of the bubbles is the number of displays we've made every year. So 6 years from now, we were buying 50 billion displays a year, and we only had 5 variables in our engine. Today, we are close to thousands of billions of displays, so there is probably a name for this number, a very big number. And because we have so much data, we can now use 140 different variables in our engine. So to conclude, what's next? Engine improvements have been one of our main levers of growth over the last few years. And every now and then, we have internal discussion asking ourselves whether this is the end, whether we've tested everything. But actually, we think the problem we are trying to solve is so rich, and the volume of data we have is so big that we are sure we are going to find new stuff. So I know what we are working on currently. I probably know what we are going to do in the following quarters, but I don't really know what we are going to do next year. But I'm sure there will be something. And for all the reasons I've tried to explain you in this presentation, I think we found the right setup to tackle those projects efficiently. Thank you.